out the defensive tackle. He broke it right up the gut.
Berger on the play fake. Now he dumps it off in the flat, and A.G. couldn't hold it at the 40-yard line. Coming up quickly from the secondary was the Rover back, Will Jones.
Mike, I think we see Auburn's offensive game plan coming into play here. They want to throw the ball on first down when they can. Little play action. Right now, they're dumping the ball off to some short people. I said earlier, they want to give Berger some confidence. They will go downfield later. They can set up that running game with some of these play action passes early. It'll help them.
Second and 10 for Auburn. They'll switch the tight end, Walter Reeves, to the far side. He's number 86. Fullwood on the delay, and he tripped. May have tripped over his own man, Vincent Jones, number 57. His left guard, who was blocking for him, and it looked like Fullwood just caught his ankle.
One of the worries of this Auburn team are their guards are very light, Jones and Cowart. Now they're going to try to run up the middle right here. You can see the center. Tamburello takes his man out of the play, and now Fullwood will just fall down. But that would have only been a 4 or 5 yard gain. They've got to get those backers out of the play. They make most of the tackles for Georgia.
Scott Bolton, number 24, number 29, Duke Donaldson of the wide receivers. They want the screen, but Georgia has a defense well. They threw it for Fullwood, but standing out there in the middle of it was Aaron Chubb, number 28. Brian Schulman will now have to come in and punt it away. And a great job by the Georgia defense on that opening series. There's Schulman averaging 44.1 yards a punt.
Mike, they're taking away those short passes outside. They're eventually going to have to go back over the middle. That's where Georgia will be vulnerable in the pass.
Fred Lane, the deep man, standing at his own 20. Pretty punt by Schulman. Hangs it high. Lane from the 20. Trying to get outside and can't. Gets to the 25-yard line. 40-yard punt. And a 4-yard return. The quarterback starting the game for Georgia, Wayne Johnson, a sophomore who started the first 3 games last season, has played very little since then. He's in there for the injured James Jackson. We'll see several backs headed by Lars Tate. The receivers have the speed to get deep and keep the defense off honest. The strength of the interior line is a tackle, especially with Strozier. Johnson is a pro-style quarterback. He'll give it off to Tate, who burrows into the center of that Auburn defense. And the defense is one of the best of the country. Tracy Rocker and Andre Bruce especially can really disrupt an offensive setup. The linebackers are 1-2 in tackles in that 5-2 setup. Crane has been the leader. The pass defense has come up with 21 interceptions in 9 ball games. Gain of 3 on the first play. Tate and McCluskey, 32 and 43, the running back. Play action. Johnson rifles it over the middle, almost intercepted right through the hands of Shan Morris, the free safety. Well, he had a lot on the ball, Pat, but it went to the wrong guy.
Well, he had a lot of time, too, which is the key right here. It was a nice play action. They set it up for a second down play. But he had nobody open. He forced this ball with the quarterback that hasn't played a lot, does this a lot of times. Actually, there's 3 defenders that were going to come into that picture. The safety would have taken the ball away over the middle. He can't force the ball. They cannot afford turnovers against this Auburn team.
To show you how inexperienced Johnson is, that was only his 5th pass of the season. He has completed 1 and had 1 interception. And they'll give it to Tate on the ground, and Tate is buried at the 30-yard line. Andre Bruce, number 93, one of the tacklers in there, and they will have to kick it away. Chris Carpenter will punt, and Trey Gaines will drop back to his own 25-yard line. Carpenter also averaging 44.1 yards a kick. Pretty punt by Carpenter, drives Gaines all the way back to the 17-yard line. Trying to get to the near side, and he'll lose a yard on the return. A 52-yard kick, -2 on the return as Warner is down there to make the tackle. That is War Eagle 6. His name is Tiger, and he is watching a nothing-nothing game from Auburn, Alabama.
Georgia at Auburn is brought to you by Mazda Cars and Trucks. The more you look, the more you like Mazda value. And by the U.S. Armed Forces. It's a great place to start.
Each team has had one possession, no blood. Nothing, nothing. First quarter, 11-22, and Auburn backed up at its own 16-yard line. Interesting game plan that Auburn has coming into this ball game, Pat. They feel they have to throw more than they have against other teams, I think because they think Georgia is better. They'll give it to Fullwood on the toss. This is the bread and butter. And Fullwood over the 20, 30, 35, 40, 42-yard line. And remember what I said to you earlier this week? Why do they want to throw when they've got Fullwood?
Well, I think they want to set up the running game, but I have to agree with you. This running game looks pretty awesome here. Trent Fullwood, what makes him so special besides his speed and the people blocking for him is his balance. Now watch this. Unbelievable. He keeps his balance there, and now he regains his speed. There are very few backs in the country who can do that. Just breaks tackles and keeps going forward.
He already has 39 yards rushing, and Tim Jesse, number 25, will come in and replace him at tailback on first down. They give it to A.G., and A.G. across the 45, maybe to the 46-yard line. We've got to have an apology to Tommy A.G. We said Tommy A.G., the baseball player, was his dad. Of course, he is not. We apologize to Tommy for that and to his parents.
Well, let's watch Tamburillo take on Harris in this play. This is a big matchup in this game. Do a lot. It'll have a lot to do with this running game. Now he just took a side and he actually got beat on that. That was a nice play by Harris. Tamburillo over extended himself and he cut back underneath. If he can handle Tamburillo, they're going to stop this running game outside.
Second and six. Berger to throw. Four-man rush. Plenty of time. Deep sideline. And it's out of bounds. Out of bounds at the 45-yard line. They were throwing for number 29, Duke Donaldson. And it looked like Berger led him by maybe a half a step too much.
And these are the type of passes they want to complete. Deeper routes down the field. This looked like an excellent throw. The question is, did he get that foot down?
Nope.
Nice call by the officials.
Sure was.
You know, a lot of times receivers will take off in midair, and they really don't need to. I don't know that he really needed to jump that high or that far, because once you take off, it's amazing how far your body will carry. Your momentum will bring you out of bounds. You should try to reach up whenever possible near the sideline.
Vincent Harris checks in at fullback. He's number 21 on third, and a passing down. They go to draw to Jesse. Boswell and Brantley make the tackle.
There are no passing downs in this running team.
Apparently not. Jesse, what a weapon to be able to bring off the bench. They got another kid by the name of James Joseph they can put in at tailback.
You know, Mike, one thing you brought up was why they're starting to run ball, but I think they're in a transitional period at Auburn. They know they're not going to have Bo Jacksons and Brent Fullwoods the rest of the decade. They need to start having a passing game. They're not bigger and stronger than everyone in the SEC, so they're going to have to start changing. That's why they brought Pat Sullivan in. I think they're doing a nice job with it.
Well, I think, too, Pat, and you see the measurement, it's going to be just shy, bringing up a fourth and inches situation. If you are going to compete for an SEC championship, a national championship, you can't be a one-dimensional football team.
Not any longer. And Pat Dye, there is Pat Dye right on the sidelines. He was smart enough to go out and get the people to change this offense. And
yes,
I know
was.
That they're recruiting heavily around the country. And unbelievably, they are going for drop-back quarterbacks.
They're recruiting heavily in Georgia, too. And look at this. Auburn out to go for it. On fourth and inches from the Georgia 48, early first quarter, Reggie Ware, number 36, in the middle of that full house backfield. They love to give it to him in short yardage, and he's got it. And it looks like he has the first down. Reggie Ware is their short yardage man. He has 10 touchdowns on the ground this year, and his long run is 13 yards. He's not going to have much of an average the way he comes in there.
Ware is a big fullback. He carries the ball well on short yardage, and they go into this unbalanced line. They have a lot of big people over there, and his second effort just gives him the first down. Actually, Georgia did an excellent job right there to stop him, almost held him from the first down.
First and 10, just outside the Georgia 46-yard line. Fullwood is back in there at tailback. Harris, number 21, is the fullback. The blitz, and they dump it over the middle of Fullwood. That is his second pass reception of the season. And he's down to the Georgia 39-yard line. Aaron Chubb in on the tackle right now. Let's get out of the sideline and Tim Brando. Tim?
We're on the Georgia sidelines, Mike. There is still no sign of James Jackson. Now, we talked to Vince Dooley earlier. He said he thought Jackson might get here at some time. But even if he got here, it would be likely he would not play. He would have to go with Wayne Johnson. And Johnson has been taking all the snaps all week long.
Thank you, Tim. 9 minutes to go. First quarter, nothing, nothing. This is a good drive going for Auburn. Forward. Straight up the middle, found a big seam, keeps his feet for another first down to the Georgia 27.
Well, we've already seen the ability of Auburn to go outside with Fullwood, and he goes inside very well. That's the second run he's had tonight, over 10 yards, right up the gut. Tamburello just takes Harris right out of the play. Now, you have to remember again, he's a man outside of him. He has to move, snap the ball, and move over a couple yards to get him. Now, watch. Fullwood just cut right behind the block, right inside. That's what he does so well. He reads the blocks. He's strong enough to go inside and fast enough to go outside.
They'll go up the middle this time, down to about the 22-yard line. Larry Burnett has a scoreboard update for us. Larry?
It's top-ranked Miami, the Hurricanes, taking on Tulsa, the Golden Hurricane. And in the first quarter, Miami's Melvin Bratton takes it in from 2 yards out. Miami's Hurricanes leading it 7-0, first quarter at the Orange Bowl.
Miami is so tough. We saw Penn State pull out a thriller over Notre Dame today. Michigan losing, so those are numbers 1 and 2. Second down, 5 yards to go for Auburn. Jesse on the toss behind Harris. And Boswell has him at the 21-yard line. Georgia's problem has been on defense this year. It's unusual to look at a Vince Dooley football team that has trouble stopping people.
Well, to be honest with you, I think they've been out-recruited for a couple of years, and it's finally caught up to them. They just don't have the big people. A couple of excellent players they had. Henry Harris has been hurt a lot this year, and John Little, they're all SEC safety. They had to move him from rover back to safety. He's been dinged up the whole year. He's not playing so far tonight.
No, he's not in there. And when you have, when you're small, inexperienced, and not too fast, you've got problems. Fullwood. Driving near the first down. He had to reach the 17-yard line. We'll wait and see where the mark is. Interesting about Fullwood, they feel he's going to be a good receiver. They simply haven't thrown him the ball very much, and if you don't get a chance to catch it too much, you're never going to have the chance to develop yourself.
And he's going to have to develop that skill very quickly to excel in the NFL. You have to be able to catch and run there. You know, that's what's interesting. They seldom got the ball to Bo Jackson. You know, someone like Brent Fullwood, you think they change their philosophy a little bit, and they just haven't done it.
It is a first down, the fourth of this drive. It's a first down for Auburn at the Georgia 17-yard line. Fullwood. And they kept a great contain that time, and it was number 3, Gary Moss, the right corner, who came up. He was lined up in the left corner that time and simply wouldn't let Fullwood outside. There's Pat Sullivan with a headset on, next to head coach Pat Dye. Boy, could Sullivan throw it. Holy cow, what a great quarterback he was.
Well, he broke a lot of hearts in the Ivy League when he got the Heisman Trophy over Ed Marinero. Mourning in the East.
Yeah, but when you guys mourned, you just went to the library.
Every morning.
Second and 9, Auburn. Jesse. Somehow got through there. Inside the 10 to the 8-yard line. Dropped by Miles Smith, the 5'11 junior who is starting at the safety position tonight.
Well, Tim, Jesse's averaging 4.7 this year, so he's no slack when he gets to the backfield. He scored 3 touchdowns. He also has good balance. And the key, again, they have such an excellent line. If they take on people, they open up their backs and give them some room, keep their balance, and go north and south. And that's what the tailbacks do so well for Auburn. They run the ball toward the other goal line.
Third and short, they'll go with the full house backfield again. Keep your eye on number 36, Reggie Ware. Instead, they'll toss it to Fullwood. Fullwood's got the first down inside the 5 to the 4. It is first and goal, Auburn. Funny about game plans. Auburn had planned all week to come out and throw the football, throw the football, throw the football, and this drive they have simply run it down their throat.
That's good coaching when you make that adjustment. And another thing they do so well, these short yards and the goal line, they're so strong with having 2 tackles on that unbalanced line. It's awfully difficult to stop them. And they're going to start mixing in that pass later and be that much tougher.
Reggie Ware, touchdown Auburn. Gets his his 11th rushing touchdown of the season, and Auburn is on top 6-0. Chris Knapp will come on to try the point after he has been perfect this year. 45 out of 45, he has missed only one in his career. He hooked that one a little bit, but he got it through.
Well, you know you have a good running game when you have a specialist that just scores touchdowns for you. They open up the defense. Here, cut back, and he's just so strong. He stays very low, keeps his legs moving, falls in the end zone.
With 5 minutes and 5 seconds to go in the first quarter, our score, Auburn 7 and Georgia nothing. I always number 8, Lewis, to the near side. Lane is averaging almost 30 yards a kickoff return. But it's Lewis from the 7. And driven out of bounds hard at the 25. Pat, let's take a look at the last touchdown.
Right on your left of your screen here, you'll be able to see they're short on this side, but 86 right on the left of your screen is going to come down and double the nose tackle right there with his hands, and that helps the guard Cowart. Now he'll come and pick up Boswell, the linebacker, and that frees him to fall into the end zone, because no one man's going to stop Reggie Ware. He just carried him in.
There's the scoring drive. Impressive it was, covering 84 yards and taking more than 6 minutes off the first quarter clock. Lane Johnson is the quarterback, has played sparingly since the first 3 games of 1985. And he'll give it off this time to David McCluskey, number 43, as fullback. And McCluskey slugs it out for a couple of yards up the middle. Edward Phillips, number 46, off the bottom of the pile. There are McCluskey's numbers. He has been alternating with Henderson, who has had a knee injury. Second and 6. Johnson straight back under pressure, wants to screen it, and does to Tate. Defense very well by Auburn, but he almost got the first down nonetheless. The tackle by Kurt Crane, the inside linebacker, number 39.
Well, Tracy Rocker is a potential All-American, number 74, top of your screen. Now, he thinks he's going to get a sack here, but it's a screen. Now he's going to try to run the play down. That's what's special about him. He has great speed for his size, and he just hustles all over the field, which is, you know, the best trait a defensive lineman can have is pursuit, strength and pursuit.
Third and a yard for Georgia. 7-man front for Auburn on defense. Berry is the man in motion. Tate on the sweep, got outside, first down, and driven out of bounds shy of the 40-yard line. Unusual to see a team go outside on a short yardage situation.
Well, they ran into the short side of the field, too, which even makes it tougher. Now, right now, I think they have to go to some play action on first down. I know going into the game, they planned on doing it. Now, they had to change their quarterbacks, but really, this plays into Wayne Johnson's strength. Fake it, fake that ball up the gut where they've been running on first down, drop down, back, and throw the ball downfield to the receivers, particularly across the middle.
Well, the regular quarterback, Jackson, because of his grandmother's death, was apparently given the option by Vince Dooley to come tonight or to stay in Camillo, Georgia, and they have not seen him yet. Johnson guns it over the middle to Osborne and complete at the Auburn 44-yard line.
Well, they might hire me as offensive coordinator right here.
Nah.
This is a nice call. First down. It wasn't a play action, just a straight drop back, but they're going to go across the middle. Osborne's an excellent receiver, and this is a bullet. He can drill this ball right between 3 defenders. Nice throw.
And Johnson watching. Yes, sir. Young man does have an arm, doesn't he? His second completion of the season. Make it his third, as he had hit in a screen pass. They give it off to Tate. Tate runs over one tackler. He gets down to the 39-yard line. He ran over Brian Smith, number 90, Kurt Crane, and came in and helped out on the stop. Tate is 209 pounds out of Indianapolis. In high school, he broke all of Robert Lovett's high school rushing marks. Lovett went on to star at Georgia Tech and now with the Dallas Cowboys. He's not in a great spot for a running back, though, behind Herschel and Tony, huh? Gonna have to wait till he's 50 to get the play. Second and 5. And they'll go with a fullback, McCluskey, down to the 37-yard line. Nate Hill, number 99, who alternates with Ron Stallworth, 92, at a right defensive tackle position around the stop.
And this is where Auburn is so tough on these third and fours and fives, because they're so strong with their front 3, their linebackers are so active, and their secondary is very confident.
part of that sellout crowd of 72,500, and they are doing a renovation on the stadium here. They'll be up to 85,000 by the start of next year, and just a beautiful place to see a football game. Third and two. Tate on the sweep. Cut it back. 30, 25, 24-yard line. First down, Georgia. Tim Worley, the other tailback, the man that alternated with him, is out for the season with a knee injury, so it's been all up to Lars Tate.
Well, this is the second time they've gone outside to him. You pointed it out the first time. Short yardage, they're going outside. They have a lot of confidence in their fullbacks blocking, and their tackle, Wilbur Strozier, really opened this play, and he broke the tackle. And cuts back here. Had he got right there, had he gone straight, he might have scored. I'm not a running back. I can't tell him what to do, but one cut too many, in my opinion.
Nice block by David McCluskey. Excellent kick-out block to let him cut back where there was room to run. Johnson, under pressure, he'll run it. Inside the 20 to about the 19-yard line. Good job by Johnson to get 5 yards out of a potential sack. Andre Bruce was a man who was applying pressure from the outside.
Well, that's the type of play they designed. They put in the offense for someone like James Jackson, their quarterback, who isn't playing this evening. Very quick, very good runner. But actually, Wayne did a nice job turning that ball up. He saw he didn't have a receiver. He kind of lumbered along for 4 or 5 yards. Nice job.
And it's second and six. They'll give him 4 on the carry. Mark it at the 20. Auburn leading 7-0 with 1:05 to go first quarter. Auburn showing blitz. They come with 5 men. Lars Tate breaks it up the middle. Very close to the first down. They'll stop him at the 10, about a yard shy. Tate, as you see, the numbers in the first quarter, 32 yards. He's had 3 straight 100-yard games after Worley went down with an injury, and the first Georgia running back since Herschel Walker to have 3 straight 100-yard games. He's a good one. And a junior. Third in the yard. Let's see if they try to go outside again, Pat. They've done it 2 consecutive times on third and short. Quarterback sneak. And Johnson inside the 19. Looks like he has plenty for the first down. Well, that's the way offenses are designed. They run outside a couple of times, maybe loosening the middle up a little bit.
Well, that was a very nice first down. They went outside, they went inside, and they picked it up with the quarterback. That's mixing it up well.
Auburn had a sustained drive to score, and now Georgia has come back with their 5th first down on this drive. And we're going to have time run out in the first quarter. You see Vince Dooley, he doesn't want him to snap the ball again as we're down to 3 seconds. He wants to be able to talk it over before the second quarter. And that is the end of the first period. Our score, Auburn 7 and Georgia nothing. That's the story after one quarter, but Georgia is trying to change everything on this drive. They are going against the odds because Auburn has not allowed a first half touchdown this year. Georgia, however, first and 10 from the Auburn 13-yard line, and it's been an impressive drive, Pat.
Oh, and I don't have a calculator, but that's 242 points to 15 points Auburn's outscored their opponents in the first half.
Take the deep man in the eye. Osborne in motion. Option. And Johnson keeps and gets to the 10. This is something we had not expected to see out of Wayne Johnson. He is primarily a drop-back quarterback, although at 6'4", 203, he is big enough to run the option.
Didn't
and not all
good.
That slow either.
No, but didn't look real good on that play. I think, again, particularly down in this the red zone, inside the 20-yard line, you've got to go those early downs play action. You've got to get the ball on the crossing routes. Let's look for the tight end on this play.
Wide receiver split left is John Thomas. Osborne goes that way in motion. Tate. Only to the 8-yard line. Kurt Crane and Tracy Rocker, number 74, on the stop. And Vince Dooley talking to his offensive coaching staff on a 3rd and 5. Dooley has been at one institution longer than only one other coach has been there longer. That's Billy Yeoman, who has already announced his retirement at Houston. So Dooley will have that on him next year. 35, big play for Georgia. They have to score points because Auburn is going to get its points. Johnson throws
nice
back.
Touch.
Wide open, Sadowski, touchdown.
Wow, it was a play late. Beautiful.
Wayne Johnson rolled left, turned back right, and Stadowski was wide open. The first touchdown pass of the year for the sophomore from Columbus, Georgia. And Steve Crumley will come on to try to tie it up. Crumley, one of a dying breed, the straightaway place kickers, but he's a good one. 28 of 28 on the year, and we're tied at 7.
Well, here's the first touchdown against this Auburn defense in the first half the entire year. It's an excellent call by the coaches. She's going to roll left. The tight end's going to sneak back. Sadowski's sneaking back. No one picks him up. Touchdown. You know, so often, Mike, you hear about individual effort by the players, how talented they are, but coaches don't get enough credit sometimes. And this was an excellent call by Coach Vince Dooley and his offensive staff.
Get into it, Vince.
I tried that cool.
13:45 to go in the half. We're tied at 7. Georgia and Auburn.
Tonight's game is brought to you by Jeep. There's a feeling you can get only in a Jeep.
13 minutes, 45 seconds left to go. First half of play from Auburn at 7-7. Georgia kicking off high, short kick. And a fair catch signal is taken at the 28-yard line by Lawyer Tillman, one of the up men. And Auburn will start from there.
That was a smart play. A lot of players might not have fair caught that ball, and that could have been trouble.
A lot of people don't know you can fair catch a kickoff. Lawyer Tillman obviously did. And that's good coaching when your players do things like that. It really is. It's a reflection of being prepared. Ball spotted just shy of the 29-yard line. First and 10. See how the Tigers respond to being tied up. Fullwood is in there at the tailback. And they'll give it to him. Bounces off one tackle. Coming up from the secondary, Will Jones, number 29, the first man in on the tackle for Georgia. After Auburn had a great scoring drive, Georgia came back and was equally impressive, going 75 yards with more than 6 minutes. That's about the same time that Auburn took the score, and Sadowski with a 7-yard touchdown pass, and we're tied at 7.
Wayne Johnson made his presence known on that. Some nice passes, a couple of nice runs also.
Young man has a fine arm, and that time he showed some touch. He had Sadowski wide open and just floated it in there to him. Fumble by A.G. Looked like he got it back at the 32. Looked like he just ran past the handoff there from Berger.
Well, he never had this ball. It looked like it was almost at his knees when he handed it off. Real low. He didn't have that ball. Very fortunate here. It wasn't a turnover. Bounced right up to him. You know, we said earlier in the year we had South Carolina and Georgia. They have not had any good bounces this year on fumbles.
No.
When they fumble, they lose it, and the other team always seems to fall on it.
That's right. Third and 7 now. Harris, number 21, in at fullback, and Jesse at tailback. Jesse goes to a wing. Nobody behind Berger. Plenty of time on a four-man rush off to Jesse, dumped it short. And Georgia's defense closed beautifully and stopped him shy of the first down. Nice effort out there. Terry Webster, number 60, got out there and helped on the tackle. And great pass defense by those Georgia linebackers.
It was a nice tackle. Plus, some people might not have seen that Lawyer Tillman, who's usually their possession receiver, the cornerback, knocked him out of his route at about 5 yards. Took him out of the play, and they had to go short, and they stopped it.
Schulman to punt. Two-man rush gets away another rocket. And Lane is driven back to the 14-yard line, pinched on the sideline. Away from a couple. And got it back to the 24-yard line. Good job by Lane, a 10-yard return after a 48-yard punt. With 11:51 to go first half, it's Auburn 7 and Georgia 7.
This is Jeep's all-new 4-liter six-cylinder engine. It has sequential multi-point electronic fuel injection. It puts out 173 horsepower and 220 foot-pounds of torque. But most important, if you put this new engine in a Jeep Cherokee or a Jeep Comanche, you're going to see more speed and power than you've ever seen from vehicles like this. Just remember where you saw it first.
Can the Redskins' George Rogers run roughshod through the 49ers' defense? Find out this week on Zenith Monday Night Matchup.
11 minutes, 51 seconds to go first half. Mike Patrick, Pat McAnally, and Tim Brando. It's great to have you with us for CFA football on Saturday night on ESPN. And we've got a good one here. Georgia with the football, first and 10 at its own 25-yard line. Henderson is in for the first time, and he's in at a tailback spot and gets it up to the 31-yard line. He used to be a tailback, and they were stocked at full tailback with Worley and Tate, so they wanted to find a place for him. Take a look at some scores for you. Miami now up 10-0 over the Hurricane. California taking it again, 14-3 this time from Southern Cal. Tulane leading Memphis State. And McNeese State up 3-0 first quarter. Second and three right here for Georgia. Henderson again. Not this time. Got about a yard and a half, which will leave him about a yard and a half shy.
The two middle backers in this 5-2 defense for Auburn have like 180 some tackles between them. They are tough. Enough to get his helmet taken off and still want to make the play. Kirk Crane, 39, lost his helmet. And Edward Phillips, 46. Those two middle backers will make a ton of tackles tonight.
Crane is unusual because he's a transfer from Memphis State. He's become the leader of the defense. Third and a yard. McCluskey and Tate, the backs. Tate, first down and more. 40, still on his feet and almost broken. Just brought down by Kurt Crane, who was hanging on to that left ankle. Otherwise, Lars Tate is gone.
You have to be impressed with the calls they're making on short. A lot of these short yardage plays are making nice calls. Going outside, inside. Now the backers are going to blitz inside. Just gets beat. Cut inside. Nice cutoff block. But again, the coaching staff mixing it up, going outside early, and now they're going up the middle on these short yardage plays.
Hiawatha Berry, number 39, is in fullback. He's a former defensive lineman, 250 pounds. Johnson, nice play, fake plenty of time, drops it off. He's got his tight end, Kirk Warner.
Johnson's pass, complete to number 83, Kirk Warner. Warner out.
Johnson, very, very cool. And it was interesting what Vince Dooley said when he said Johnson was going to start. He said he's not even worried about it. He's just going to show up and do it.
That's right. Vince said that he just wasn't, he's just a big player. You know, he's a big kid. He just wants to play. He's not nervous at all. And he's sure shown it out there.
Well, if you don't get nervous about this one, you're not going to get nervous. Game of six, second and four, Georgia. They've moved the ball extremely well in the first half. Henderson, cut it back. Cut it back again. 30. 20-yard line of Auburn. What a run by Keith Henderson, the sophomore fullback, now back at tailback.
Well, it helps to be an ex-defensive lineman when you're in a fullback and you have a fullback at tailback. Hiawatha Berry, number 39, just drills the defender. And Keith Henderson does the rest. He's not your typical fullback when he's playing tailback. Watch Berry. Takes him right out of the play. No problem now. Look at Henderson. This is a guy that usually plays fullback, but they had to find a spot for him, so they got him in tailback because of injuries. Nice run.
Vince Dooley said he was the most mature freshman he had ever had. This year he's a sophomore. First and 10, Georgia, going for the lead. McCluskey got a little gap up the middle. Kurt Crane and Ron Stallworth made the tackle. 9 minutes, 22 seconds to go. Second quarter of play from Auburn, Alabama. It's Auburn and Georgia, 7-7. Each team has had a long drive to score its touchdown. And now Georgia down, as the experts would say, by 10 points entering this ballgame, is threatening to take the lead on second and six. The back to the eye, McCluskey and Tate, number 32, are the back. This is Tate. Nothing this time. Tracy Rocker wrapped him up at the line of scrimmage. Big number 74. Preseason All-SEC choice. Take a look as we update you on some other scores. Pick out your favorite team and your favorite sport for that matter. A lot going on this time of year. Big play here on third and four. Auburn adjusting its defense.
I think they'll probably roll the wide side of the field, take Wayne Johnson out of the pocket, give him the option to run or pass. I doubt they would go back to that delay to Sadowski.
And Georgia has just called its first time out of the first half to talk about what they'll do on third and four. So with a timeout on the field, We'll be back to Auburn, Alabama after you listen to this.
There's something new on the road. It's built by Jeep. It's the kind of truck only Jeep could build. But it's also the kind of truck just about anybody can afford. The new short bed Jeep Comanche Sport Truck. It's worth a look.
Auburn offensive lineman Yan Cowart talks about the importance of education.
Being an architecture major at Auburn University and playing football are both very similar. They're both very demanding and time-consuming. If you don't handle your time correctly, you'll find yourself falling behind in one of those areas. They are both very rewarding in the fact that architecture is a mind shaper and football is a character builder. But the biggest reward of all is that architecture will last me the rest of my life.
Georgia facing third and four inside the Auburn 15-yard line. We're tied at seven.
It's a nice time to go to your tight ends and maybe roll that to the right side of the field and try to get a tight end on a crossing route.
Well, they got two of them in there right now, and they'll give it off instead to the fullback. We'll make it the tailback, Henderson. Keep wanting to call him a fullback because that's what he's listed as this year. He gets to the 10 and very close to a first down. And they'll stop the clock to measure it.
One of the best things you can do when you have a quarterback that hasn't played much and you're playing a superior defensive team is to mix your plays up very well. It's play calling becomes more and more critical when you're outmanned physically and you have young players, and that's what the Georgia staff's done so well. They've mixed them up well.
Here's the measurement. And they've got it. First down, Georgia. Henderson is coming back off a knee injury, and it has been the year of the knee injury for the Georgia Bulldogs. Then he was disciplined earlier this week for being late to a team meeting, and he has come off the bench. Sometimes that'll really fire somebody up, you know?
Well, he's also their best receiver. We saw him earlier in the year, and they were very high on him.
First and 10. Tate really whacked by Kurt Crean, number 39, and on the bottom of the pile, Edward Phillips, 46, and they drilled him.
Well, we saw like Kurt Crane has 110 tackles this year. It really helps, though, when you hit people and you keep your headgear on. You know, the other play, his helmet was off. You don't want to hit somebody with just your skull.
Crane, the transfer from Memphis State. Auburn recruited him as a high school player, didn't get him. He's out of Birmingham. Second and 10. McCluskey and Henderson, the running back, behind Johnson. Looks like Georgia may have jumped offside. I believe it was the right guard, Kim Stevens, number 68, about a half a count ahead of the ball. And that will cost the Bulldogs five.
They actually did that on their last drive going in this direction. When they scored, they didn't see it on one of the earlier plays. Did you notice they...
Looked like one of the backs got a jump on that one.
Dead ball, fall start, lineman moves, offense.
First penalty of the ball game. Would be nice if they changed the college rules to identify players by number as they do in the pros. It would help a little bit. Certainly help us. Occasionally we can pick out who it is, but not always. Second and 15 now for Jordan. Henderson. Big Benji Rowland was waiting for him.
Well, nose guards can make a difference on a defense. He just beat Todd Wheeler in a second. He was in the backfield, and they're fortunate this wasn't a turnover. He just gets in the backfield almost quicker than the offense, right there. No chance, nice tackle. those nose guards can wreak havoc in the middle of the line if the centers don't handle them. And they'll, you know, we talked a lot about Tamborello, and Wheeler's going to have to do his job too.
Another Georgia player on this Auburn squad. There are a lot of them. Third and 18. And now they'll go with McCluskey. And McCluskey only gets down to the 14-yard line. And obvious that Georgia was not willing to gamble on anything. They just want to go for the field goal. And that'll bring on Steve Crumley.
Well, that's twice in this game that they've had third and long. And they've run the ball right up the middle very conservatively. The first time for a punt, second time for a field goal. Evidently, they feel they can keep close enough and score the points when they can and play defense when they have to.
You saw what Crumley did a week ago. He's had an up and down year. Twice he has kicked four field goals in a game. But he is only 11 out of 19 on the season. This will be a 32-yard attempt. Plenty of distance and right through. And Steve Crumley has given the Georgia Bulldogs the lead here at Jordan-Hare Stadium in Auburn, Alabama. With 5:36 to go in the half, it's a three-point ball game. Underdog Georgia has taken a 10-7 lead over Auburn with 5:36 to go first half and a good ball game. Crumley kicking off, coming to the near side and picked up by James Joseph. Joseph had a seam and is out over the 30-yard line to about the 33, and Auburn will start in good field position. The Auburn defense, which gives up 83 yards a game on the season, has already allowed 107 so far, and Georgia got most of its yards in that drive on the ground, 61 of them, in fact. Another drive that took more than 6 minutes, and they're up 10-7. Auburn with the ball at its own 33-yard line. Gainis in motion. Fullwood. Boswell, Brantley, Aaron Chubb, number 28. Everybody got a shot at him, and he is a marked man. Fullwood, 71 yards on 9 carries in the first half.
Well, Auburn's going back to their bread and butter. They're going to go to Brent Fullwood. Sprint draw. They fake to the right now. Cut back. Notice the strength he has. It's not just fast. When he breaks tackles, he just runs right over the first tackler, who is a linebacker. Just a beautiful combination of speed and strength.
Second and 3. This is Jesse, who is in for Fullwood. And he gets to the 45-yard line. That will be an Auburn first down, and we've got something from the sideline from Tim Brando. Tim?
Mike and Pat, John Little, you see behind me, number 19, the safety, has not played to this point, and the Georgia defense has changed a little bit because of that. What they're doing, Pat, is they're disguising some of their blitzes. Georgia in the past has been a team that blitzed a great deal. They're trying to give some two deep covers in the zones for the other safety that's in the game for him, and they're also trying to help Greg Williams, the corner on the left side, in this play right here.
Thank you, Tim. First and 10, Auburn. Jesse. He'll only get a couple this time, wrapped up by big number 72, Larry Brown, the 255-pound junior guard.
And the reason, you know, Tim, that's good information. The reason they're trying to help Greg Williams, he's only like 5'9". They don't want him matched up with Lawyer Tillman, who's a big receiver for Auburn, who's 6'4". That's just too big a mismatch. And they want to double cut. That cover two is where they send both safeties and double team the outside receivers, and they're going to rely on their linebackers to stop the ball up the middle.
Donaldson and Tillman are the wide receivers. Split left and right, and they will go to Fullwood back in the ballgame. Fullwood hit at the 50. A flag is down. And it was thrown right at A.G., who was trying to throw a block on the outside against Vince Guthrie, one of the outside linebackers. See what the call is. And it's a hold.
You know, Mike, we talked to the receivers coach, who's also calls the plays, Larry Blakeney for Auburn, and he said, you know, he's been there a long time and through a number of running eras, and he says what worries him is they just have in their nature. It's their nature to call running plays, and they're going into their shell. They came out passing, now they're running.
There's A.G. coming off the field. We'll get a look at him here. You probably are going to see the holding against Vince Guthrie on the right side.
I just took him right down, and this puts him in a tough situation. This is where Auburn's going to have to throw the ball, and that's just trying to say that it's hard to break habits. And Auburn has run the ball for so long that their play calling gets progressively more conservative if the score is close, and it really cost them the Florida game in the end.
Yes, it did. And they admit they went into a shell in that Florida game. They had the lead, and they just thought they'd try to protect it.
They're doing
Tillman
right
85, Bolton 24 in the ballgame on second and 17. Berger deep down the middle, intercepted. It's picked off by Gary Moss. Moss makes the big play, his fifth interception of the season. And Georgia is playing Auburn off its feet.
This is not the type of ball that Auburn wants to play. They want to mix up. Jeff Berger is not the most talented, gifted quarterback. And Pat Sullivan said his arm is not that strong. They want to set him up and throw when they aren't expecting it. Right here, Georgia's just back in their zone. Look at three guys. He forced that ball. No way into a zone you can throw a ball and complete that. There's three defenders right there. Moss happened to be the one to pick it off. Two other guys could have had it. Got to pick your spots to throw the ball if you're Auburn.
Moss makes the big play, and Georgia, already leading 10-7, is going for more with 3:24 to go in a half there in Auburn territory. And around, it's Osborne. Got some room. 20, 15, and Arthur Johnson was the man who made the tackle number 40. He missed him the first time and came back and got him the second time.
Oh, but what a game plan. Here it is again. First down, you don't have to always throw the ball. Ball's a reverse. Auburn just wasn't looking for it. They're mixing up their plays. Big gamble here. Fake option. Oh, nice design on that. A fake option goes back to Osborne the other way. Now it's just speed. Right, it's a great effort to come back and make this tackle, but Osborne had enough speed to break that play.
A great play design. Tate trying to get outside.
Well, that was really
brought down by Phillips and Bruce. Let's go to Larry Burnett.
With Auburn struggling, LSU trying to stay alive in the SEC race. They get on the board first. David Brown-Dyke, a 38-yard field goal at Starkville, Mississippi. LSU leading Mississippi State 3-0, first quarter.
What an interesting design on that play. You have Wayne Johnson in a quarterback who's not that big a threat as a runner. So you run the option, you pitch it back the other way to the flanker. Totally unexpected.
They've done a good job because they had run it once before to set it up. Second and 8. Tate got a big hole inside the 10 to the 8-yard line. The hole closed quickly, but you could have driven a truck through it initially.
Well, that's the play they run so effectively to fool it. Auburn does. It's just a sprint draw. The quarterback comes out. Tailback gets the ball deep, and he reads, and he cuts back like that against the grain. Awfully tough to defense.
99, Nate Hill is checking in on the Auburn defensive line on 3rd and 3. Henderson is in there as the Georgia tailback, number 30. And he's got it. Trying to go outside. No, sir. Kurt Crane, number 39, is the guy who got there, and Auburn strung that play out beautifully.
Well, one of the keys to an effective pitch and play to go outside to your tailback is you have to have a nice throw. This is low. He doesn't handle it well. And he's not that fast getting outside. It gives the linebacker time to run it down, and Crane did run it down in a hurry.
Now, Georgia has taken another timeout. They will be facing a 4th and 4. Will Crumley come in or not? We'll find out when we come back to Auburn, Alabama. One minute, 29 seconds left to go in the first half. Georgia leading 10-7, and this is Steve Crumley, who will come on to try a 26-yard field goal. He has already made one from 32. And he drives it through. And the Georgia Bulldogs have really surprised the Auburn Tigers and have taken a 13-7 lead with a minute 25 to go in the first half.
This is why there are no gimmies for field goal kickers. Right on the bottom of the screen, Kevin Porter is going to come right around and almost block this kick. If it's mishandled at all, even a tenth of a second, that ball's down the ground.
Kicking situation is a tenth of a second is an eternity. Georgia to kick it off. And Fullwood will take it to 10. And driven out of bounds at the 23-yard line. And Auburn will have 1:21 to work on their offense. After the interception, Georgia converts with a field goal 26 yards out by Crumley. They drove it 39 yards and got into that field goal position. Crumley is now hit from 32 and 26. And Georgia has done an excellent job on offense, and they've gotten 13 points out of it.
What do you bet? Will Auburn go conservative here, or will they try to put some points on the board?
I would think they wouldn't try to do anything fancy. Saw the numbers on Berger, and he'll give on the draw to Fulwell. Brantley brings him down. Well, I'm one for one. I quit.
That shows your maturity and your intelligence right there.
And Auburn will take its time. We've seen so many teams to take a chance here in the closing stages of the half and give up points.
Well, I think Auburn feels that they can come back in the second half, get into their game plan, mix in the passes better, and they'll be better off than just throwing it up in the air right now.
Able to pull it back again, and this time Fulwood really gets it. Wycliffe Lovelace, number 94, got a hold of the left leg and just would not let go.
Well, Henry Harris, he's the big player on the down line. He's the only experienced player coming back. Right here, knocks him, 52. He'll handle him, hold him off, and then make the tackle. If he can control, again, they have light guards. Coward and Jones are very light for Auburn. If he can handle them and make plays like that, the running game will be in trouble.
On third and one, Auburn is just letting the clock run down. They're going to have to snap it one more time. But they just appear content to run it out. Harris trying to cut it outside, and he's brought down at the 35-yard line. Good tackle by Will Jones, number 29. But that'll be the end of the first half, and some of the Auburn fans not real happy about the strategy in the last minute and 12 seconds. And now it is first down, so they stop the clock, move the chains with 2 seconds to go, and then they restart the clock, and the half is over with Georgia doing an excellent job offensively and defensively, and they lead the Auburn Tigers here at home 13-7. Right now, let's go back to Bristol, Connecticut, and a scoreboard update with Larry Burnett.
Remind you once again that Georgia is leading Auburn at halftime in their game here on ESPN tonight. Georgia, a great success story. They've had a lot of backups helping them this year, and Tim Brando's got a story on one more backup that's doing well for Georgia.
Our score here at halftime at Jordan-Hare Stadium is Georgia 13 and Auburn 7. A big game tonight for Georgia and for the Bulldogs this year. It has been the year of the knee. They have lost several players, but they have come back tonight to lead the Auburn Tigers.
Knee injuries have plagued the Georgia Bulldogs all year. First tailback Tim Worley was lost for the season with a knee. Fullback Keith Henderson went down a week later with the same injury. Then perhaps came the most emotional loss of the season as mascot Uga Four injured his knee falling out of bed before the Vanderbilt game. 2 weeks ago, a very emotional moment in Georgia sports history as Uga was carted out onto the field prior to the Richmond game. It was obvious that he wasn't himself, but as most Georgia Bulldogs of the past, he played well with pain. Fans and alumni alike were proud to see Uga Four out on the field prior to such a big game. It was Uga's brother Otto that was called in from the kennel to take over, and he's done an admirable job. Otto had never been to a football game prior to this one. Now he's led Georgia to 2 out of 3 victories. He has truly earned the respect of everyone at Georgia, including his coach Vince Dooley.
But if we had the same depth at all the other positions, we'd have done all right this year. Otto, who has replaced Uga, has done a tremendous job, and we're very, very pleased with the reserve strength that we have with our mascot.
Fellas, I tell you, I had an opportunity to talk with Otto prior to the start of this game, and just moments ago at halftime, I asked him what the transition was like for him taking over for his brother, and he said, rough. Then I said, well, what about the second half? What do you think it's going to be like? He said, rough. I guess it's going to be a very rough second half, Mike and Pat.
Tim, I don't know how you get away with this stuff, but he asked him who the greatest home run hitter of all time was. He'd probably say, Ruth. And then you'd send him away, and the dog would say, well, maybe I should have said Aaron. ESPN's live presentation of CFA football will continue next Saturday when LSU plays host to Notre Dame. Our coverage begins at 7 o'clock Eastern with the Mercury College Football Scoreboard Show. I told myself I wasn't going to tell that bad joke, and I went ahead and did it. Auburn will kick off. Georgia leading 13-7 will receive. Lane number 4 to the near side, and Lewis number 8 to the far side. Awaiting Chris Knapp's kickoff. And he booms it deep. It's Lewis, 2 yards deep. Lane says down it there, and he will. Take a look at the halftime statistics, and Georgia has rolled up almost as many yards overall as Auburn gives up in an entire ballgame. Certainly in the rushing department, they've exceeded it.
Well, they've done very well, and what's disappointing, I think, for Auburners, they've only thrown 7 passes in the first half and only 4 in their final 4 drives. But the biggest statistic right now is that Georgia scored 13 points and 9 opponents only scored 15 against Auburn in the first half earlier throughout the season.
We'll talk more about Auburn's passing when they get the football for the first time. Tate is back in the tailback. McCluskey 43 in front of him, and Tate will get the first carry. 5-6 yards and dragging people with him. An 8-yard gain for Lars Tate. Here's what Georgia was able to do in the first half. The first possession, they only got off 4 plays and had to punt. After that, 2 excellent drives, a 13-play drive that resulted in their touchdown and a 12-play drive that they got a field goal out of. And then after an interception, they got another field goal for their 13 points. Tate now 60 yards on 13 carries. Second and 2, long signal count. Tate again, picking his way, got to the 30.
I'll tell you, Mike, you chalk up those long drives and those nice series to the play calling. The coaches have really mixed it up nicely. They've been able to go with the tailback outside and inside. They've went with the reverse. They've thrown the ball effectively when they've had to, and that's why they're leading this game.
And they're doing it with Wayne Johnson, a backup quarterback who has played sparingly since the 4th game of last year. He started the first 3, did not throw the ball that well, and had only 4 passes this season coming in. It is 3rd and inches. And Georgia will jump offside. It's the right guard, Kim Stevens, the second time he has done that tonight. Now, interesting, where the ball was spotted, I think it was moved by the center, it would have been a first down.
Oh, he definitely jumped offside. That's twice for Kim Stevens, who the coaching staff considers to be their finest offensive lineman. Very surprising.
Very low penalty count in the ballgame, only 3, and they've all been small. And Vince Dooley doesn't like mistakes. He knows he has to play mistake-free tonight. 3rd and now 5. They'll split the backs. Tate and McCluskey. Johnson to throw. Under pressure. And they've got him inside the 10. The sack to Benji Rowland. Big number 96, and Johnson just couldn't get away. There is a flag down on the play near the line of scrimmage. We'll check it for you. And it's going to be a hold against Georgia. Auburn will decline that and take the loss on the play. Really, the first big defensive play Auburn has had.
Right in the middle of your screen, on the left, Rocker's just going to overpower Strozier. He's going to put pressure on the quarterback and force him out of the pocket, and he really got held by Strozier. That's just power football, and then in comes the nose tackle to make the sack. Chalk that one up to outstanding play by Tracy Rocker.
Carpenter standing in the shadow of the goalpost.
Literally.
Will have to kick it away, and Trey Gaines standing at his own 42-yard line waiting for it. Good snap, no pressure, and Carpenter got a wobbly kick out of there. Gaines fair catch at the Georgia 47-yard line, a 39-yard kick. Here's what Auburn did when they had the ball in the first half. The first drive went 6 plays, but then they had to punt. Then their best drive, in fact, their only good drive of the ball game, 14 plays. It went 84 yards for a touchdown. Then they had to punt. The next drive resulted in an interception. And then halftime as they killed the clock. Auburn has not thrown the ball effectively. They told us they wanted to pass. And here is Berger to throw on first down. And he's wide open at the 30, driven out of bounds. Now, this is what they had planned to do all week, Pat, but they did not do it in the first half. And you go back to the things that that brought you there, and that's the running game.
They went into their shell, but they know they've got Lawyer Tillman, one of the finest receivers in the country, 6'4". He'll play action on first down, no problem with protection. He's going against a couple cornerbacks that are 5'9 and 5'10. There's no way. That's too big a mismatch. They've got to do that more. Throw on first down.
Vincent Harris, number 21, is into the ballgame. Fullwood now goes behind him in the eye. And they'll give it to Harris. Harris inside the 25 to about the 24. Thrown back, Wyco Lovelace, number 94, is in on the tackle, along with Boswell. Frank Thomas, 87, will check in at tight end for Auburn for Walter Reeves.
You know, it won't be in the statistics, but the key to this drive right now, their field position was at offsides by Stevens, or else George would have had an easy first down there.
On the third and inches.
That's right.
Second and five for the Tigers. Fullwood. They were waiting for him. He got a couple still on his feet. Fullwood, 20-15. The official stopped him. They said he was out of bounds.
He's too good for the game.
That's right. And he is really upset. Brent Fullwood with tremendous strength, tremendous balance.
And that's definitely a bad whistle by the officials. He was never stopped. His progress, he continued moving his legs and he was running. They just aren't accustomed to a human being able to take this many hits and stays upright. This should have been a touchdown for Fullwood. Now he stopped up, but his legs won't stop. Watch. He's still moving outside. He's still going. No way. That's much too quick a whistle. Auburn got cheated out of a touchdown. What a play by Fullwood.
Yeah, and he did not step out of bounds. That was a quick whistle, and it cost him 7 points. Third and five. Jesse in motion. Berger dumps it out to A.G. A.G. couldn't hold it. It's just as well he didn't catch it because Larry Brown put him on his back. Tough break for Auburn there.
Well, that run by Fullwood would have gone in the highlight films for the country. That was one of the just an excellent effort. He was denied.
So Chris Knapp will come on for a field goal attempt. He is 9 out of 17, but 6 of those misses have come from more than 40 yards. This will be a 41-yard attempt. Plenty of leg on it, and it's through the heart of the goalpost. Let's see what happened to Fullwood after he realized the whistle had blown and the referee stopped him. He did not care for it one little bit. Georgia by 3.
Why you bother me, boy? Are you crazy?
I'm a chicken, Hawk, and you're a chicken. Are you coming quietly, or do I have to muss you up?
You're going at it all wrong, son. You gotta go to Kentucky Fried Chicken if you want to catch America's favorite chicken. It's a great place to get a great meal. No one makes tender, juicy chicken like the Colonel. It's finger-licking good. Here, son, let me give you a lift.
We do chicken right.
Sending a letter overnight was once a prerogative reserved only for the very rich and the very wasteful. Now, with the UPS Next Day Air letter, everyone can send a letter overnight. At a paltry $8.50, you may think of it as the overnight letter for the very smart and the very frugal. UPS, we run the tightest ship in the shipping business.
Georgia at Auburn is brought to you by BMW, the ultimate driving machine. To arrange a thorough test drive, simply phone your nearest BMW dealer.
With 11:31 to go in the third quarter of play, Georgia deep to receive with Lane and Lewis. And this is Chris Knapp, who made the 41-yard field goal and had plenty of leg on it. Lewis, 10-yard line. Across the 25 to about the 26 where he's driven out of bounds. Let's take a look at the play where it was whistled dead.
Well, this is an opportunity to watch an exceptional athlete. Just this is one of the great plays of the season right here. He stopped. Two people hit him, but he continues to move his leg. He moves outside. There's no way that play should have blown dead. He breaks that tackle, and he's gone. No way. That's a touchdown.
Now, this is in normal speed, and I think you get a better indication of it.
This could turn out to be the play of the game right here.
Oh, no chance. Very, very quick whistle. It might have been an inadvertent whistle for all we know, but it did blow. McCluskey, the fullback, not much. First man to hit him was 98 Robert Goff.
McCluskey picks up 2 yards.
The junior out of Bradenton, Florida, who is one of the better pass rushers on the Auburn defensive line.
We talked about Auburn getting too conservative. Now, Georgia can't go away from their game plan. They've got to throw these balls on first and second down. They can't just keep running the ball up the middle.
Second and eight. Osborne comes toward us. Tate. Lars Tate has had a fine game. He's run really well out to the 32. Kurt Crane on the tackle again. Auburn, after getting excellent field position, was able to go 23 yards only in five plays and set up Chris Knapp's 41-yard field goal to cut it from 13-7 to 13-10. There is the bigger Bulldog. Third and four, and the Auburn crowd really firing up the defense. Johnson changing his formation, moving his wide receiver. They'll run the option again. He keeps. Nice effort by Johnson to get the first down to the 37.
Big, strong kid. That was an excellent move. Got inside, broke that tackle. It's surprising. You don't expect Wayne Johnson to run the option this well. He's not the quickest man in the world, but now he'll turn it up. Now he'll just use his strength. Break that tackle and fall forward. First down. That was a nice call. Option play was a gamble on that.
One thing we should point out is that Auburn knows virtually nothing about Wayne Johnson, and it's very difficult to prepare for that.
This looks like a pass to me out of the split back.
Instead, they go play action, and McCluskey on the draw will get across the 40 to about the 42. Phillips makes the tackle along with Andre Bruce, and we'll update you on some other scores. Alabama, of course, won today in a non-conference game over Temple. Virginia Tech beating Vanderbilt after being behind early. Mississippi probably knocked out of the race, but 22-10. And Kentucky, in a real surprise, beat Florida 10-3. Back to action, second and five for Georgia. Trying to keep it on the ground. Tate just bursts forward to the 47. They'll mark it between the 47 and the 48. May have another first down. Tate just exploded through the line that time.
One reason they've been able to run the ball well tonight, Georgia, is because Stevens and Strozier, right there on the right of your screen, 68 and 79. They take their men, they give Tate room and enough time to get his momentum going where he can either jump over the top or, if he can land on his feet, break a longer run.
The guys who have been here 4 years for Georgia have not beaten Auburn, and they desperately want to. Emotion still plays such a tremendous part in this game. First and 10 from the 48. Lars Tate in Auburn territory, fumble. Georgia got it back at the 50. A fortunate bounce for Georgia, and the Bulldogs have not had many of those this year. And it's McCluskey with a recovery.
When they played South Carolina earlier in the year, we saw their players actually fall on the ball and lose it somehow. This is another nice deep handoff. Give him time to read and cut inside, and he just gets hit right on the ball. Rocker, Tracy Rocker, with another big hit. And they're very fortunate to recover that.
Henderson will check in the tailback now, and Hiawatha Berry, number 39, the 245, 250 pounder, is in at fullback. And second and seven, and they'll give it to Henderson. Big hole for Henderson. He's close to another first down at the Auburn 42-yard line, and they're making a living off that left side.
Well, they've really used Keith Henderson effectively tonight. And Wilbur Strozier, we've talked about him a number of times. You don't see tackles and guards pull in tandem this well very often. Strozier's very fast for his size. He leads the hole right up through the hole, and Henderson follows him. And there's really nobody in the way until he hits the ground.
It was tough to tell who Strozier blocked because he just completely obliterated him from the picture. And they'll bring in the change from the far sideline to measure. You know it's a good block when you can't even identify the guy who gets flattened, and Strozier just pancaked it. And it's a first down. Georgia with 13 first downs in this ball game, and Auburn has a defense that's been giving up 82.9 yards a game. That's one of the best in the country.
Well, it's just the design of the plays. And that play, they sent Hiawatha Berry to the right, who took out Rocker, and then they cut back left behind the tackle and guard. Nice design.
Clock running with 7 minutes and 19 seconds to go, third quarter. It's a 13-10 Georgia lead over Auburn. Tate is back in there, and Henderson now at fullback. Play action.
Henderson
open, 30, 25. And he just put his head down and drilled Shan Morris, knocked him out of the play, and it's another first down for the Tigers. And you've got to give Vince Dooley and his coaching staff a lot of credit for this design of the offense, along with Wayne Johnson, who has just done a superb job at quarterback.
Well, he really has. They're mixing plays up, and Wayne Johnson just standing back there throwing nice passes, and he took a sack earlier. He's playing an intelligent game, and Henderson is a fine receiver out of the backfield, and he's already shown his running ability.
First and 10, the ball now at the Auburn 23, well within the range of Steve Crumley, the field goal kicker. McCluskey cuts it back. 14-yard line. The tackle made by Arthur Johnson, number 40. And Georgia is really fired up.
Johnson follows Mike the stop.
They pull Stevens and Strozier again. We saw this play earlier. And McCluskey's able to cut back against the grain. You'll see him pull left. And he'll cut right behind him. Nice little lane in there. He found it. But the key is Stevens and Strozier are so active on that offensive line.
Second and one for the Bulldogs. McCluskey looked like he got the first down, hanging onto his ankles. Ron Stallworth, number 92. Stallworth, another sophomore. He's from Pensacola, Florida, 260. This is a very young Auburn defense that has excelled all year across the front. Four sophomores and a junior. The linebackers, two juniors. The only seniors are in the secondary, and there's two of them. So the cupboard will not be bare next season. Here's another sophomore, Wayne Johnson, the quarterback who has not started since the beginning of last year. And he's done quite a job. It is a first and 10, Georgia. Henderson, again behind Strozier down to the 6-yard line. And Strozier is down. Big Wilbur Strozier holding onto his leg.
Timeout for the injured Georgia player.
And he's holding onto that left knee, obviously in pain. And this is the last guy they can afford to lose up front. This guy at 262 runs a 4.740,
and that's legitimate. What they've done, Mike, they keep running left with him. They're pulling Stevens and the tackle, which is very unusual, and they keep cutting back or they keep following him up. The backs are reading Strozier and Stevens, and he's just going to get hit from behind on this play, which happens a lot of times when you pull right here.
Looked like Henderson may have stepped on his leg and twisted his knee.
Nice block.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he did. His knee hit the outside of Strozier's left knee and bent it in.
But that was a perfect picture of why they've been able to run the ball. He's kicking the guy out, and he's cutting underneath it.
We'll check on Wilbur Strozier when we come back right after this. And it looks like another knee injury has struck down a Georgia starter. Wilbur Strozier in obvious discomfort being helped off the field.
And the irony, Mike, is they have not played a game this year on AstroTurf. It's all been on grass.
Watch Henderson's left knee. It bangs into Strozier's left knee, and it's not supposed to bend that way, folks.
And his cleat stuck. See, he had the longer cleats on the grass, and his knee just didn't give.
Strozier being helped off the field, and now on second and four, Scott Adams, number 75, is in at right tackle for Strozier. Johnson on the options, got room to run. Touchdown, Georgia. Wayne Johnson, the sophomore Bulldog quarterback, has come in here and done quite a job for Vince Dooley, hasn't he, Pat?
That's the beauty of college sports. You just never know. This guy comes in here, and nobody expects him to run the option. I mean, I remember you and I kind of silently scoffed the first time.
Sure.
Now he's run it to perfection, and he's throwing the ball well. But Vince Dooley said the guy has no fear. He wasn't nervous at all about starting.
Crumley will come on for the point after. It is 19-10, and Crumley knocks it through. And the underdog Georgia Bulldogs are up by 10.
They're absolutely just catching Auburn unprepared for these plays. He has nobody. He could have pitched this ball for a touchdown, too. There is nobody who's going to stop this play. Just got outside, faked the ball up the middle. Play calling again.
Big, strong kid. And Vince Dooley has put his hopes on Wayne Johnson tonight. And the hopes are coming true as Georgia leads Auburn 20-10.
Georgia defensive back John Little talks about the importance of education.
The dream of every college player is to play professional football. That's always been a dream of mine, too. But in reality, only a small number ever make it professional sports. On the other hand, earning a degree can create lifetime opportunities for everyone. I'm convinced that studying hard, making it in the classroom, and really hitting the books is the key to success in today's society.
The preceding message has been brought to you by the College Football Association.
Wayne Johnson on the sideline, the young man who has run for a touchdown, thrown for a touchdown. He has really done the job. Joseph at the 18 on a high short kickoff. Back to the 30, and he will be buried there. Auburn will start from the 30-yard line. And the Tigers are down, something they're not used to, 20-10. And Georgia has just racked up its third scoring drive that has taken more than 6 minutes tonight. This one took 6 minutes and 27 seconds. They went 74 yards, and Johnson scores on the option play. A beautifully conceived offense tonight for the Georgia Bulldogs. Our official attendance, 73,000. That means we have 500 standing room here at beautiful Jordan-Hare Stadium. Forward on the toss. Brantley got a piece of him, couldn't hold him, and he'll get 5 yards out of it. Ball comes loose. I think it was after the whistle, or was it?
Well, that was awful close, but I think
the officials are looking.
They'll call it down, but that was very close.
No, the officials are looking to see who has it. Georgia came out with a football.
They'll call it down.
Oh, they should have called it down a long time ago. You can't wait to see who recovers it and then call it down. And Vince Dooley doesn't care for that very much. I thought he was down, but I thought the officials should have called it.
Well, let's see if this is a fumble or if the officials made the right call.
Can't tell from there. Looked like he was down. Back to live action and nothing as Boswell 44 sticks it in there. Tim Brando has a report from the sideline. Tim.
Wilbur Strozier is out for the year. I'm with Dr. William Muehlheren now of the Georgia Bulldogs. Explain the injury that he incurred.
Well, actually, he got clipped in the legal zone and got his medial collateral ligament and anterior cruciate torn, which is going to end his football for this year. But we feel that we can repair it and he can return to play next year or maybe this spring.
Thank you, Doctor.
And thank you, Tim. Third and six, and that is devastating news for Strozier and Georgia. That is one of the real tough knee injuries you're going to have. Berger throwing sideline. Lawyer Tillman couldn't hold it. Had enough for the first down, couldn't hold the football, and Georgia has the momentum going their way.
Well, I think Auburn's painting themselves into a corner. I think they're going into their shell offensively. Larry Blakeney told us yesterday that they're worried that they do that when they don't come out and throw the ball well. And I just don't think they can afford to do it. Georgia's got the momentum right now.
Schulman to punt, and Lane is deep to receive. Little pressure, almost got there. Schulman hangs it high. Lane at the 24. No place to go. A 2-yard return after a 41-yard punt, and with 3:18 to go, third period of play, it is now Georgia over Auburn. Our score is 20-10.
Good times coming. Guide says, take a look at what's in store. What's in store for you in every...
3:18 to go, third quarter. Mike Patrick, Pat McAnally, and Tim Brando with you from Auburn, Alabama. And Pat, the longer this game goes, the more idea you have. Georgia believes it can win now.
They came in determined to take this game. They don't consider themselves out of the bowl picture.
First and 10 at the 25, and they certainly are not. McCluskey. And McCluskey has run very hard tonight, as have the other Georgia backs. He has almost five. Kurt Crane, number 39, was in on the tackle. Again, Crane is always around the ball. He and Phillips, 46, the other linebacker. But Georgia's just teeing off on the ground game, and then they have thrown in an end around and a couple of strategic passes. Johnson is 5 out of 6, 54 yards passing and a touchdown. He also rushed for a touchdown. Second and 5. Henderson is now in there at the tailback in a blitz, and Crane makes the tackle in the backfield. Now that was strictly a run blitz, and Kurt Crane picks his spot, and he hit Henderson hard.
Well, when you start moving the ball against when they're moving the ball against your team, you got to start gambling with your backers, and Kurt Crane is definitely the guy to go to. He just splits the seam right there, and no chance for the running back. He's a very intelligent backer. They say he's very mature. It doesn't look the fastest or the strongest, but he just makes tackle after tackle.
Auburn gambling a little more on defense, trying to make something happen. It's now 3rd and 7. Passing down for Wayne Johnson. It is. Four-man rush under pressure. Screen to Tate. A flag is down. and Crane comes back to make the tackle. It'll be shy of the first down, and we'll check the penalty for you. That's a nice, safe passing call on third and seven, but Auburn defensed it well.
This would be unusual if it's an offensive holding call, because normally you want those guys to rush.
But it is.
That's what I thought it was. That's an error by an offensive lineman, because you want those guys to come in and pressure the quarterback and then dump it outside.
Yeah, no sense to hold them if you want them to get through anyhow. And they will turn down the penalty and bring up a fourth down and force Chris Carpenter onto the field for the Bulldogs. And Trey Gaines will go back to the suit.
And we talked earlier about the pros announcing. It would have been interesting to see if it was Scott Adams with that holding call coming in for Stroger. Hadn't played a lot of tackles, mostly a guard.
That's right. But he was in on one offensive play on the last series, and he scored, so he was one for one, at least until this started. Carpenter back. Auburn had 10 men on the line of scrimmage. Now they back off of it. Beautiful punt. Very high, and Gaines signals fair catch. Makes it at the 19. A little bobble, but he held on. And
that's
a flag goes down as they ran into Trey Gaines.
No, that is an error by the official. If you fumbled the ball, if you bobbled it at all, they can tee off on you. That is an error right there. Trey Gaines did not catch the ball cleanly. You bobble it around, you can then hit the guy. Does not have to hit the ground. I hope that they discuss this and figure it out.
Vince Dooley is trying to point it out to the official. And that's exactly, you can see his hand motion. That's exactly what he told him, that the ball was bobbled, and it was obvious that it was. And now I think the official is saying, no, I guess he didn't bobble it.
Yes, he did, definitely.
But he did. And Vince Dooley getting getting his coaching staff back off the sideline.
Well, you hope the officials will get together and figure this out and make the correct call. A lot of times they do.
Now, one of them held up his hand and indicated five.
See, I think they're going to figure it out and they're going to make the right call.
No penalty.
Now, that is an excellent job of officiating, even though the crowd here at Auburn doesn't like it. Because the other official saw what happened and went to the man who made the call and said, look, the ball was bobbled, maybe you didn't see it. That's the way officials, in my mind, are supposed to work together.
No question. You call for a fair catch, you're fair game if you bobble the ball right here. That is definitely, he can be hit. In fact, they could have knocked him out of his can. They're lucky that they barely touched him. Could have caused a fumble.
Auburn going to the air. Lawyer Tillman, what a catch.
What a weapon.
Holy cow, what a catch at the 35. Berger hung it out there, and Lawyer Tillman just spread himself in the air and made the grab.
Why they don't use him more? I know that Brent Fullwood's a great weapon, but look at Lawyer Tillman lay out for this ball. He's 6'4", tremendous basketball player in high school. Oh. Look at that catch.
Oh.
Oh, you just can't do it any better.
Superb grab by Lawyer Tillman. And Auburn throwing on first down, and when they do that, they've got people open. Forward as a flag goes down, and the two inside linebackers, Brantley and Boswell, in the middle of that tackle. It looks like it's going to be a hold against Auburn, and it is. That'll make it first and 20. See if we can see it on the replay.
53, Jan Cowart, right in the middle of the screen. He's going to hold the linebacker, 44, right there. He's got a hold of him, on the arm. That's an easy call for the officials.
Once the hands get away from the body, it's easy to see. Of course, they say there's holding on every play. There probably is, but they're only going to call the ones that are flagrant, at least normal. Here's the call.
Holding, 1 yard beyond the neutral zone, offense.
I'll tell you one thing, the NFL, if they ever see this film, they're going to be envious of our cameramen because these are easy calls to make on those instant replays.
Sure are.
They're clean and clear.
These guys haven't missed a thing, have they? Again. Tough situation for Berger. He's got first and 20. Let's see what Auburn goes into the bag of tricks and comes out with. Berger, plenty of time. Good throw this time. Out to the 40-yard line, he hits Scott Bolton. A Berger can throw the ball as long as you don't ask him to throw it 25 yards over the middle or the deep out. He's got the arm to get it there, and he needs to throw on first down to have the element of surprise in his favor.
Well, that was a nice job. He just sat in the pocket. He had no problem as far as the pass rush, and he delivered the ball. Nice low, had a lot of speed on it. Nice grab by Colton.
Only has 61 yards on the night, but he's only thrown the ball 12 times. A gain of 15, so it's second and five. They go back to the ground with Fullwood trying to get outside. And Georgia has just laid for him, and why not? He is the threat. And even though he has been a marked man, he's gained nearly 90 yards on the night, 15 carries, 85 yards for Brent Fullwood, who's had five straight games, and the worst of those five, Pat, is 120 yards. And he doesn't play the whole game either.
Now, the real shame is that he spent 3 years behind Bo Jackson.
Yeah.
It would have been something to see him.
And that is the end of the third quarter here at Jordan-Hare Stadium in Auburn, Alabama. Our score at the end of three periods, Georgia 20 and Auburn 10.
Full line of Daly's cocktail mixes at your favorite store.
It's time for another Safeco Insurance pop quiz. Here's today's question. Safeco is able to offer you more protection for your money because A, they only insure careful drivers, B, they only insure careful homeowners, or C, they only insure people with freckles. If you answered C, you are excused from this commercial. But if you answered A or B, you could save with Safeco home and auto insurance. Safeco, the smart choice.
Confused about all the changes in financial services these days? You're not alone. That's why the Foundation for Savings Institutions has prepared an informational series that'll help you understand the changes, and more importantly, what those changes mean to you and to your money. This series will appear regularly in magazines and newspapers all over the country. If you can't find it in the publications you read, write to the Foundation for this free guide, Today's Financial Services. It'll tell you what you need to know.
Not everyone got a vacation this summer.
I need a vacation. What do you need, some glasses? How many fingers can you see?
This fall, you can still get great low fares to more places on the biggest bargain airline, United.
I got a vacation.
Have a nice shower, Pecorni.
I'm not just flying.
Get out.
I'm flying friendly
skies. I'm out of there.
15 minutes of football left at Auburn, Alabama, and if you have an orange and blue face, it might not be long enough. Auburn down by 10, third and three. From their own 42, full house backfield, Fullwood on the toss. First down. That's all they wanted, go to that full house backfield with Reggie Ware in there in the middle.
Well, they run to the short side. Again, they have the two tackles on the left side. This is the right side, just the guard and Reeves, the tight end. Walter Reeves takes him right out of the play, and he picks up the first down.
Reeves, the tight end, is taking on a 199-pound rover back by the name of Will Jones. And it's a little mismatch. First and 10, Auburn. Fullwood trying to get outside. Broke one tackle, couldn't break a second one. Excellent tackle by Vince Guthrie. Let's go to Larry Burnett, who has a scoreboard update. Larry?
At the Orange Bowl in Miami, third quarter now, and they've just finished it up going into the fourth, but this is third quarter action. Vinny Testaverde to Brian Blades, 58 yards on the score. It is now 23-3, Miami leading Tulsa in the fourth quarter.
Well, we saw that arm the first game of the year. Testaverde, down distance just doesn't matter.
He is scary, absolutely frightening. If you were a defensive coordinator, he's the last person on the face of the earth you want to see. Berger dumps it off, hits his tight end Reeves, gets to the 50. Still going to be about 7 yards shy of a first down, and it'll bring up third and seven. Reeves was doing a good job of protecting the ball, but might have been able to get some more out of that one. There was another thing they wanted to do tonight, Pat, was throw more to the tight end.
They haven't been able to get the ball to Reeves. He's been relegated to being a blocker. He's doing the best he can there. I know he wants to get that ball in his hands. They haven't gotten the ball to Fullwood or Reeves, the two people they had determined they were going to throw to, because Tillman's already a known threat.
Ball in midfield. Berger has hit 7 out of 13, but he only has 65 yards on the night. Jesse is the tailback behind Harris. Fake. Berger guns it, sideline complete to Lawyer Tillman. First down at the 30-yard line. Good throw that time.
Oh, this is a nice throw, but what a pattern. This is called a shake pattern or a Z out. He's actually doubled here, but the short man's just going to take away the zone. Now he's going to run to the post. Now cut right back underneath the guy. Just leaves him. No way he can guard him. Lawyer Tillman is very underrated. He's averaging 23 yards a catch. He's 6'4". He's fast. He showed there he's got excellent patterns. He's got to go to him more.
First and 10. Auburn driving down by 10 points. They're at the Georgia 30. Jesse on the toss. And Georgia playing some tough defense. Maybe their best defensive effort of the entire season tonight. Tim Brando is down at the sideline. Tim?
Mike and Pat, I had an opportunity to eavesdrop just moments ago. Pat Sullivan wants Jeff Berger to stay with the game plan, use old reliable when they need 3 yards, and that's the toss sweep to Brent Fullwood, and then keep setting up Lawyer Tillman. They may break it deep to Tillman on this drive. Let's watch for it.
Thank you, Tim, and they've certainly done better since they started throwing like this. Oh. Almost intercepted. Great play by John Brantley. Got his hands on it and couldn't hold it. And Brantley, as well as the other Georgian linebackers, not known for their pass defense.
This would have been a tremendous interception. But Berger drops back again all kinds of time. That's because of the effectiveness of the running game. One hands his ball. He had a receiver open, Bolton again, and he had the tight end Reeves totally uncovered on a sneak pattern across. I wouldn't be surprised if they went back to that. No one even guarded him.
But that was just a great play by Brantley.
And he had Bolton. He threw to the right guy on that in that instance. Georgia's just playing above their heads right now. They're making the plays when they need to.
Third and 7, Auburn. Fullwood is back in their tailback. He gets it on the draw. And they shut it down. He got inside the 25 to about the 24. But they'll be about 3 yards shy of the first down, bring up a fourth down situation. What do you do here, Coach? Do you go for the three? You need two scores in the last 12 minutes and 14 seconds.
Well, I think most teams would go and kick a field goal here. I think that Auburn will go for it because they have a lot of confidence in that short yardage technique they use with the unbalanced line to come back to the wide side, and they are going to go for it.
Opponents have gone on fourth down 11 times against Georgia this year. They have made it 10.
Computers help. I think I'm sure they had that going into this game.
Full house backfield. Fullwood. That's the bread and butter play, and he didn't get it. He didn't even get close. The Bulldogs have held and take over on down. That's Ronnie Smith. And Boswell lead the celebration.
Georgia just gambled on this. They thought they were going to go back to the weak side once again, and they went one too many times. They just got enough bodies over there to stop his progress. He never had a chance to turn it up. Oh, they had three people unblocked. I just think, really, they gambled. They just said they're going to go to our left side, and we're just going to put the people over there. They slanted left.
Would have been about a 40-yard field goal, something to remember. 12:08 to go in the game, a 10-point game.
Tonight's game is brought to you by IBM and the growing family of IBM personal computers. And by the heartbeat of America, today's Chevrolet.
12 minutes and 8 seconds left to go at Auburn, where Georgia leads the heavily favored Tigers 20-10, and they have the football at their own 22.
That's another jolt of adrenaline, another confidence builder for that Georgia team.
And they don't need any more confidence. They're doing just fine. Tate turned a corner. Bumped out of bounds by Kevin Porter. Georgia's just done an excellent job in all phases of the game tonight.
Well, they've run 14 times this half. They've only thrown twice. Both of them were completed passes. But it's the way they're using the run. They're going inside, outside, using different personnel, both at the blocking back and with their tailback between Tate and Henderson. It's been very effective.
Gain of 8 on that last play. In case you joined us late, James Jackson, normally the starting quarterback, had been injured all week. His grandmother died this week. He was away for the funeral. Is not here tonight, and Johnson is starting in his place and has done a fine job running the offense as Georgia gets a first down out to the 34. you don't think the Auburn Tigers know what's happening to them? They're down by 10, and it's under 12 minutes to go. And this would dump them out of a three-way tie for first place in the Southeastern Conference. And the only conference game they have left is Alabama, the one they look forward to.
Question is, were they looking forward to next week?
Yeah, past Georgia. First and 10. McCluskey. Didn't get much there.
You know, you look at a game like this and you say, well, did Georgia just come in and play above their heads? Was Auburn just not prepared, looking past Alabama? And the thing is, Auburn has not made errors. They haven't made a lot of mistakes.
Haven't. And I don't think that's the case. I think Georgia has just played their hearts out on defense, where they've staked their claim to this game.
And they've used their minds on offense. They've used the personnel perfectly.
Want to thank our spotters, Kevin Robinson, Jeff Blanton, Mark Parkman, and our statistician, as always, Chuck Levy, for a great job tonight. Second and 9, and it's been a whale of a ball game. Blitz, and Tate is stopped after a gain of a yard, maybe two. Let's go to Larry Burnett in Bristol for a scoreboard update.
Okay, Mike, Pac-10 action now. Fourth quarter, USC up 21-3, and Ryan Knight takes it in from 3 yards out. It's his fourth touchdown of the game, USC leading it 28-3. It's in the fourth quarter.
Our story here, 10 and a half minutes left. Georgia leading Auburn 20-10, third and 7. Really, all Georgia needs is not any more points right now. They just need to work some time off the clock, and they've been very good at it in this ballgame. Three drives to the taken more than 6 minutes off the clock each time. And they'd like another one. Tate pins out of a tackle, but not enough as he gets to the 40-yard line. Kirk Crane pins him to the ground.
That's pretty much been their game plan coming in. If they had third and long, they just weren't willing to put the ball up and have their turnovers. They're going to throw the ball on their terms when they wanted at the time they thought was most advantageous, and you got to respect them for sticking with it.
Well, Auburn has, 21 interceptions this year for a very opportunistic defense. There is Chris Carpenter, who's done a beautiful job of punting tonight, and Trey Gaines standing at his own 15. Auburn once again had 10 men on the line and then back off of it, not going for the block. Shorter kick this time, end over end, and Gaines has to let it bounce, and it takes a Bulldog bounce to the 15-yard line. So Auburn will start with poor field position after a 44-yard kick. It's a 10-point ball game.
Taking your business on the road can be a cumbersome task, and productivity can easily fall off. Presenting the IBM PC Convertible, a powerful personal computer that easily converts to a full-function portable. One you can use in a train, a plane, a car, or a meeting. And be as productive on the road as you are at the office. The IBM PC Convertible. One computer for people who really need two.
Feel the thunder. Put yourself in today's Chevrolet Camaro IROC Z and listen to your heartbeat.
The heartbeat of America.
Chevrolet.
Day Chevrolet.
Kickboxing Super Heavyweight Championship. Bad Brad Hepton meets Melvin Hitman Cole. Live Thursday night at 10 Eastern on ESPN.
Well, that's Chris Carpenter, the punter. He's had an excellent night tonight. He's averaged over 45 yards net. Looks like he has a little groin problem there, but he'll be back in. Punters don't sit down very long.
You are having a terrible influence on our statistician with your puns.
Right there. See, as soon as he sees, that's what's funny. Carpenter sees it, makes sure it's 44-yard net. He had a nice little roll on it. Then it started hurting.
As I said, Chuck Freeby is taking a line from you. He says Carpenter nailed that one.
Oh, boy. He would say that.
He's got to stop with the punch. First and 10, 15. Auburn desperately needing to get something going. Berger sacked. Larry Brown got him from behind. Really the first time Georgia's had any pass pressure.
I think they just guessed again. I think it was a matter of time. They have to start passing on first down. I think they've waited too long, Auburn has. In this case, Larry Brown just beats his guy and gets in and makes his tackle. It was obvious that he had no receivers open on that play. But I just think Auburn's waited too long. They've just put themselves in a position where Georgia right now is gambling intelligently and making the plays.
It's second down and 17. Berger from the goal line. And it's complete to Reeves. No, the official says he crashed it at the 15-yard line. So it's going to bring up third and 17. And the crowd's starting to get restless here. They see a shot at the SEC title slipping away.
Well, that's twice now we've seen that same instance where they've had second and long, and they've gone to a 6 or 7 yard pass, which really wouldn't help them that much because there was no chance of picking up. They threw one to Reeves
right
earlier. That's not the pass you want to throw in that situation. You'd be better off with a screen or something with Fullwood and give him a chance to run.
The clock becoming the factor. 8 minutes and 40 seconds to go. It is a 10-point ball game. Auburn must score twice. Fullwood is back in there. Maybe they'll try to throw it to him. He stays in the block.
They're going up top to Tillman, but they've got double coverage on it.
Lawyer Tillman out. Jumped everybody. Couldn't catch it. It's intercepted by Will Jones of Georgia. Lawyer Tillman got his hands on it. Wasn't his fault. He couldn't hold it because it was good defense. And Jones on the tip drill makes the interception.
Well, Jeff Berger just decided he was simply going to go up top to Lawyer Tillman on this, and it was a nice call by the Georgia defense. They had a double coverage. They had this cover two, again, where the free safety will go over the top to help the underneath man, the corner, and they just weren't going to give up the deep ball. Now, here's where 6'4" comes into play, though, and while it's not a terrible throw to go to him, he almost caught this ball, and then it went off his knee, and it was intercepted. But Jeff Berger's got to read it out. He can't just force the ball.
The second interception tonight, and Georgia in great field position near midfield. Johnson, under pressure, runs out of the pocket and goes down in Auburn territory at the 49-yard line. Boy, Ron Stallworth had a bead on him, and if Johnson sets up the throw, he gets popped.
Well, this is almost a great, great catch by Lawyer Tillman. And this is just the kind of night it's been. It goes off his own knee, and it's picked off. It's the kind of night it's been for Auburn, and Georgia has just been there at the right time.
Second and 8 for the Bulldogs at the Auburn 49. 7:58 left.
How about them throwing it first down, though? That
yeah
was a surprising move. And Johnson showed good speed outrunning Stallworth.
Your fine young quarterback. Done a great job tonight. Here comes the blitz. Henderson. Auburn gambled and lost as Henderson first right through the gap left by the blitzing linebackers and picked up 11. Tim Brando has an update on Carpenter from the sideline. Tim?
Chris Carpenter has tendonitis in his left knee, and that is his plant foot, Pat, and that is what was causing him the problem. What looked to be a groin pull there, actually it's tendonitis in his left knee, and that's his plant foot, but he'll be back in.
Thanks, Tim. That's very unusual. You notice his average there, 48.2 gross and 48.6 net. That's very unusual.
Means he had some great coverage downfield from his teammates. First and 10. Tate really popped by Benji Rowland. The line of scrimmage may have picked up one, but Georgia doing exactly what it wants to do right now. Running time off the clock. We're down to 7:05 and counting.
I think it's one of those cases where they've played almost a perfect game.
I agree with you.
They've had great individual effort, and then they've had some fortunate breaks, like the early whistle that would have been a touchdown, that interception. They've taken advantage of it.
Excellent game plan.
No turnovers. They've had fine punting and coverage, like we said. That's how you win games. That's how you upset teams like Auburn.
Second and 9. Georgia just working on the clock. The more first downs, the better off they are. Tate hit by Stallworth. Got to the 37. But each play and the interval in between taking about 40 seconds.
The other thing is Georgia's playing great defense. I mean, I don't think they have any fear of the Auburn attack right now. I think they're looking forward to getting back on the field and silencing this crowd further. And they have quite a number of people here, and the Redcoats, they've been loud tonight.
You have to believe that the Alabama Crimson Tide are grouped together watching this one.
Let's see if they run again on third down long and go to their punter.
And they'll go with a draw to McCluskey. Nothing there to the 34. Brought down by Andre Bruce. It'll bring up a fourth down situation.
We saw Vince Dooley there. Cameraman had a nice shot of him talking to the punter.
Well, Auburn took a timeout, Pat.
Whoa.
That's only going to leave them two for the rest of the ball game, and that's a little unusual in that situation on fourth and 6 for the defense to call a timeout. We'll check on it when we come back. 5:48 left to go. It's Georgia by 10.
I own a PC and a VCR, a condo on the beach, and my own company. But I don't own a car. I lease with GMAC.
Vince Dooley on the verge of a major upset. His Dawgs leading 20-10. That is Vince Dooley now after 23 years at the helm. This is Vince Dooley then as the Auburn team captain, the quarterback in 1953, once out past Zeke Bartkowski. And there is Pat Dye. And there is Pat Dye as an All-American lineman at Georgia, 1959 and 60. And now respective head coaches of the other school.
And those haircuts are back in.
Yeah, that's right. You wait long enough and everything comes back. Except at this point, you don't have enough hair left to wear them. 5:48 left to go. Auburn took a timeout after that last play, which means they will only have two left. And the officials, everybody just sort of milling around right now. So Georgia lets the 25-second clock run down. They're penalized 5 yards. This will move the line of scrimmage back to the 40 and give their punter, Chris Carpenter, a little more room to work.
They're going to decline it.
And it is declined.
Auburn declined it. They didn't want to give the punter the extra 5 yards on his average. I hated when teams did that.
Little chess match.
But I don't know right here, Mike, whether or not I'd go for that 52-yard field goal, or I might just run a play instead of punt. I guess they don't want to give up that easy field goal, and they try to pin him in.
Don't want to give up the field position. I think Carpenter will try to angle it for the sideline or just pop it straight up in the air, and they're coming after him, and he pops it straight up. That's a great kick by Carpenter. Gainis fakes the fair catch. Ball hits at the 5, and Georgia downs it at the 1.
What a perfect play. And you can't do it any better than that.
That's the best 33-yard punt Chris Carpenter will ever get off. Timeout with 5:37 left in the game. Georgia leads by 10.
Live CFA football on ESPN has been brought to you by Michelob. Exceptionally smooth, distinctive taste is why the night belongs to Michelob. By Casio, maker of the shock-resistant, water-resistant G-Shock. It's one tough watch to beat. By Kentucky Fried Chicken, we do chicken right. And by the U.S. Armed Forces, it's a great place to start.
It doesn't get much tougher than this. Auburn down by 10 points with 5:37 to go, and they have the ball at their own 1. They've got to go 99 yards, get it back, and do it again. Berger complete to his tight end, or complete to Lawyer Tillman, rather, with a 10-yard line, a gain of 9. Here comes the hurry-up offense. This is a good move. They have to do this. They don't have time to get 2 drives the conventional way. Berger quick over the middle to Tillman, almost intercepted again. This time it was Miles Smith, number 2, that had a hand on it.
They definitely don't want to throw the ball there. Right now they're in a cover 3 zone. They've got a free safety playing deep. They're just not going to give up the play deep to the post. They've got a safety waiting to pick this ball off. Right there, 2 people. They're covering man-to-man outside. They've got safety help. Can't force that ball. You've got to go underneath, hope for a big play, or else go under the over the middle, behind the backers, but in front of that safety.
Good coverage by Moss, and the interception almost by Miles Smith, 3rd and 1. Got to keep the drive alive no matter what, so they'll go to the running game with A.G. And A.G. out over the 11. That'll stop the clock momentarily to move the sticks for a first down. 5:04. I'm sorry, it only stops in the last 2 minutes. Now they did stop it.
I think Auburn's got to try to get the ball either their tight end or the split end across the middle, run a post pattern behind it, and get the ball underneath and try to break it on a run.
Tillman brought down by Boswell. Of course, these 5-yard gains, it's going to take you about 5 minutes to get downfield.
That's not the pass they want. They want to throw between 12 and 20 yards right in that zone behind the backers in front of those safeties that are playing deep.
Vince Dooley trying to win his 182nd game. Berger deep sideline and goes to Guinness out of bounds, 28-yard line. That was a long throw.
And he's thrown an arm. He's shown his arm tonight. He's thrown a lot of nice passes. The 20, 25-yard zone across the field.
Georgia has a man down. And it's Larry Brown, number 72. Georgia has just been decimated by injuries this year. And Larry Brown in obvious pain as they are attending to his right leg. And they want him to stand up on it. And it looks like his ankle.
Let's see if we can see how Larry Brown gets hurt. And there he comes in. He made that sack earlier. And now he tells the ref, I'm hurt. I'm hurt right now.
Somebody may, one of the Auburn linemen may have
stepped right on
his
ankle.
He went after Berger.
And I said it earlier, I like to emphasize it because I'm not pro AstroTurf. I don't like it, artificial turf, very much myself. But that's the irony in this Georgia season. All these knee injuries, and they have not played on one surface other than natural grass this year.
Sometimes it just happens. There is no explanation for it. These have been freak accidents tonight where these kids have been hurt. Berger to throw. Auburn in a lot of trouble. Berger throwing deep sideline, almost intercepted again, but it's out of bounds. Williams made the nice play. The junior came over.
One of the tricks in a good passing game, and what Pat Sullivan just hasn't been able to teach Jeff Berger yet, is the ability to key, to read his keys, to check down the receivers instead of pre-picking them in the huddle, which he's obviously doing right now.
There's Larry Brown on the sideline. They're working on his right ankle and taking it heavily over the shoe. 4:22 to go in the ball game. Georgia up by 10. Auburn second and 10 inside its own 30. Berger with time, throws, and Tillman dives for it, can't get it to 40. Berger now 11 out of 23, 109 yards, two interceptions. Tim Brando has an injury update for us. Tim?
Mike, Larry Brown just sprained his right ankle. They've retaped him. They're retaping him right now. He should be able to return to the game without much of a problem. They checked it out thoroughly. They'll certainly need him down the stretch if Auburn is successful on this drive. By the way, a little footnote. No word from James Jackson. He has not shown up on the sidelines tonight.
Thank you, Tim. 4:17 to go, third and 10. Berger to throw. And it's complete. It's going to be a first down. Trey Gaines makes the catch. If you joined us late, the quarterback, James Jackson, was injured all week, had an ankle injury. He's been bothered by an ankle throughout his career and was unable to practice. And then personal tragedy struck him as his grandmother, who was very close to him, died this week. He was at the funeral today and was given the option to come tonight or not. He was not going to start in any event because of his inability to practice this week. 4 minutes and counting. Jesse across midfield to the 49-yard line, very close to a first down. But this Auburn drive is eating up the clock. It's down to 3:45.
Well, at the opening of the show, you asked me, Mike, could Auburn just come out and beat teams like Georgia? Can they beat them with just running? And they have to set that pass up early, I said. Now they're waiting too long, and they're just giving them these short passes.
They'll call it second and two. Berger throws over the middle to Jesse, complete. It's a first down at the 41. But Georgia is going to let them have as many of these as they can get.
Particularly if they stop them from getting out of bounds. They don't mind these 5-8 to 8-yard passes in the middle of the field.
Keep in mind, Auburn has two timeouts left. They used one earlier. They'll flip it out to A.G. right through his hands and off his face guard and incomplete. Just lost his concentration. Fullbacks have not been much of a factor tonight for Auburn.
No, they really haven't, and I know it's disappointing because he's an excellent receiver normally.
Take a look at Berger after this talk. Oh, really upset. Quarterbacks don't like to put it in the hands of receivers and watch them drop it.
Berger now 14 out of 27, 143 yards. Georgia continues to go with that four-man rush. Now Berger chased out of the pocket, deep downfield. Tillman, who fell down, got up and made the catch. What a great athletic move by Lawyer Tillman.
Well, 23, Greg Williams fell down too, who was covering him. Both of them slipped. They kept the balance somehow. Now we have a wide angle. There's a cover three. Middle safety's out of your picture now. Corner at the bottom. He'll run a shake pattern again. Out to the corner. Watch, they both slipped. But Tillman got up a little faster and pulled the ball in. That big body, the defender couldn't get to the ball.
Great concentration, 29-yard gain. Auburn trying to get back in the ballgame, down by 10. Pass almost intercepted. The ball thrown very quickly, intended for Scott Bolton and thrown behind him. Not a good toss by Berger, either that or Bolton ran the wrong pattern.
Well, they blew a coverage. Georgia absolutely blew that coverage because Tillman ran into the end zone uncovered, and they had three people over guarding that short pass to the left.
There's Pat Dye. He saw it. 2:56 left. Auburn down by 10 and driving her at the Georgia 18, second and 10. Berger's throwing the ball well on this drive. Going for Tillman. Touchdown, Auburn. Lawyer Tillman, their big play man, picks it off in the end zone.
Nice throw. Again, it's a case. They're down here inside the 10, around the 10-yard line. You have a 6'4" guy against someone that's only 5'5", 5'9" or 10". Who's going to win that most of the time? The big guy.
And Auburn will go for two. They are down 20-16. You've got to like this call by Pat Dye. He wants to go for the win. No tie. Ferguson's gainus in motion. Under pressure, and he's sacked, and it's Brantley on the blitz, makes the big play, and now Auburn, down by four, will have to score a touchdown to win it.
Georgia just came up with the big play again. They blitzed, they gambled, they said, we're not going to give you this 2-point, you're going to have to earn it, and the sack couldn't be at a more opportune time. They've only gotten to him twice tonight, and both of them have been big. Look, untouched, the back blew the block on that.
The Auburn bench was trying to signal a timeout. Nobody on the field saw it. And we have a timeout with 2:51 left. It's a 4-point game.
Well, here's the biggest play of the night, the 2-point conversion. Brantley's going to make the sack, and 21, right on the left of your screen, just misses a block, the back right there. Vincent Harris just went too far to his right and left an alley open, took him down.
We understand that Auburn only had 10 players on the field. That's why someone was trying to signal timeout. Maybe it was the missing man who was supposed to throw that block. Onside kick, yes, Georgia expecting it. High bounce, and it looks like the Bulldogs have it at midfield.
Trey Gaines ran off the field, number 19. He was trying to call timeout. He must have been the extra man.
That scoring drive for Auburn that made it a 4-point game was 99 yards. What a brilliant drive. They did it to 2:46. Get the touchdown to cut the lead to four. Now, Auburn has two timeouts left. And Georgia will be intent on the clock. They get a first down, it could be over.
It will be over.
Auburn's got 11 guys within 5 yards of the ball. And the option, Johnson hanging on to the football, lost maybe a half a yard. And Crane makes the tackle, gets up, calls timeout. We're down to 2:44. Hope you've enjoyed tonight's ballgame. It has been a beauty from Auburn, Alabama, and we hope you'll be with us next week when ESPN's live presentation of CFA football continues Saturday night with LSU and Notre Dame. Our coverage begins at 7 Eastern with the Mercury College Football Scoreboard Show. LSU is winning tonight, so they would 23-0 third quarter is the last score we have. So LSU and Alabama, if the result of this game stays the same way as it is now, would be the two teams left with one loss. Who knows? As bizarre as this season has been, you might have a five-way tie for first place with two losses, and no team has ever won the Southeastern Conference with two losses. And then it would be up to the committee to decide who goes where.
And it's not like they're weak choices. They have a lot of top-notch teams.
Sure do. Sure do. This is LSU's swan song in the Southeastern Conference for this year tonight. Clock stop with 2:44 to go. Auburn with one timeout left. It is a 2nd and 10 for Georgia. Auburn playing run everybody at the line of scrimmage. Only one man is back 5 yards. And they come with a blitz as Tate tries to get outside. He'll pick up 1, 2, 3, 4 yards. Good effort by Lars Tate to get that much out of it. And Auburn will apparently not spend his last timeout right now. This is the play where they'll let the clock run, and Georgia will use all of it it can. They just mark it ready for play, and the 25-second clock starts. Third and 7. Approaching the 2-minute mark. Auburn must stop Georgia here to have a chance. Tate. He didn't get it. Stopped at the 43. Auburn signals timeout with 1:53 to go. And now Vince Dooley has really two options. He can go for it, or he can send in number 6, the man he's talking to, Chris Carpenter, to punt it. And after the last punt, you would expect Carpenter will come on.
I guarantee you they're going to punt this ball. They've had an excellent game by their entire punting team, but they've got to be careful of right now. They can't give up a blocked punt, obviously, and they've covered so well all night. The protection is the number one thing right now.
You said they've had a great game from their kicking game. They have. They've had a great game from everyone. This is, having not seen every Georgia game this year, I may be overstating it, but certainly in everything I've seen, this is by far the best game they've played all year long.
And that really goes from the coaching staff on down. I don't think this is a game that was merely won on the field by players. I really think it was the game plan. They followed it throughout. And it was the right one.
You know, I couldn't agree with you more. And a lot of times that doesn't stand out. But tonight it was obvious by the play selection they had on offense. Excuse me, by the kind of things they did on defense. It's been an extremely well-coached team. The situation is 4th and 3 for Georgia. Auburn out of timeouts. Will they go after the block? They show 10 men at the line of scrimmage. The last time they came after him and didn't get there. Now they back out of it. They'll send 8, and Carpenter pooches it very high again. A great kick. Gainus signals fair catch. It bounces short, and Georgia will down it at the 6-yard line. Tremendous punt coverage and tremendous kicking by Chris Carpenter. A 37-yard kick, and he killed it at the 6. In case you joined us late, here's the way the game went. Auburn got on the board first quarter, 7-0, as Ware scored on a 4-yard touchdown run. And then back came Georgia. Sadowski on the 7-yard touchdown pass from Johnson. Then Crumley hit on 2 consecutive field goals, first to make it 10-7 and then 13-7. Then in the third quarter, we'll check on it in a minute. 1:43 left. Auburn starts deep in its own territory. Berger dumps it over the middle, dropped by Fullwood at the 10. Probably wouldn't have gone much farther. Covered very well. Once again, back to how we got to this point in the scoring summary. 20-10 when Johnson scored on a 6-yard run. He has now run for 1 and passed for 1. That was Georgia's biggest lead of the ball game. And back comes Auburn on a 99-yard touchdown drive to score with 2:51 to go in the game. 2nd and 10, 1:39 to go. Berger deep over the middle. Warriors coming, what a catch. What tremendous concentration. The ball was knocked out of his hands. He got it back and held on. Holy cow.
Well, they squeezed it into that zone between the backers and the safeties here. You can't deliver the ball any better, and you can't ask a receiver to pull one down any better than this. He almost gets tripped right there, and he keeps his concentration and pulls it in.
Back to live action, and Berger throwing again deep out. Trey Gainus, he got it. And he's out of bounds to stop the clock, driven out of bounds by Gary Moss. Right now, Georgia has gone to its ace in the hole. John Little, number 19, the All-American rover back, who has been switched to safety and injured several times this year, has come into the ball game to try to help Georgia's defense stave off the drive. And there is John Little.
But they're throwing passes right now that take him out of the play. They're going the deep out, the routes to the Gainis outside, and then the Tillman in underneath John Little.
1:20 to go, second and one. Berger has shown a lot of cool in these last two drives. Tillman, another great catch at the Georgia 45-yard line. Lawyer Tillman is putting on an incredible show. 8 catches, 126 yards on the night. He is something else. Clock is stopped as they move the chains. Now it restarts. We're down to a minute 6. Auburn must get a touchdown. A field goal does them no good. Incomplete, out of the hands of Scott Bolton. The pass a little bit behind him.
It'll be interesting to see if, they're praying right now on the sidelines with the gloves. Auburn wants to get this game, obviously, but right now these receivers have to be tired, Mike, because they have not had to do this all year.
Yeah.
I'm sure they work on their two-minute drill, a couple of times a week, but they don't run pattern after pattern, deep. They just went 99 yards. Tillman has to be exhausted, and so does Gainis.
Berger now 19 out of 35, 220 yards, one touchdown, two interceptions early. 1 minute even to go in the game. No timeouts left for Auburn. They must get a touchdown. They're down by 4. Berger almost intercepted, and it is picked off by Boswell. And Georgia has picked off the third Berger pass of the ball game, and it looks like the Bulldogs have pulled an incredible upset.
That's the first error quarterback Jeff Berger has made in these two-minute drives.
And the Georgia contingent making the trip down here to Auburn. And there's Pat Sullivan talking to his very disappointed quarterback. And now Georgia will only have to kill the clock, and Johnson will lay on it. Auburn with no timeouts. They cannot stop the clock.
So they tried to go another crossing route to Lawyer Tillman, but it's a shorter route this time. It gave the linebackers time to get down in front of the ball. Watch. They took the ball away from him. The linebacker dropped off. What an interception. He pulled that in with one hand, dove, and caught it.
And Vince Dooley.
He tried to be cool at the beginning of the game, but he's let it go the last couple times.
Can't find a happier man there. We told you at the start of the ball game, Georgia almost every year has a major upset, no matter what level they're at. And tonight would qualify. Georgia just trying to kill the clock now. Auburn diving, desperate to get the football back. And that's going to be it. Georgia's not going to have to snap the ball again. And they may have knocked Auburn out of the Southeastern Conference championship race. They have certainly put themselves back in position for a major bowl bid as Georgia's record goes 7-3. Now we have to wait on the Sugar Bowl for the Auburn-Alabama game on November 29th. And a lot of other bowls are going to be sitting there wondering what they can do to send out invitations.
I would never have believed after we saw Auburn knock off Mississippi State and dominate them that they'd lose two games in 3 weeks.
Neither would I. And I think you have to congratulate Vince Dooley and his coaching staff for just an exceptional job in getting these kids ready. He loses his starting quarterback to a personal tragedy where his grandmother died. And you go with a guy who hasn't started since the third game of 1985. And Vince Dooley is with our sideline man, Tim Brando. Tim.
Well, there's another Boz besides Bosworth. He's Boswell. He made a great catch to ensure the victory. That was quite a two-minute drill Auburn had going there.
Well, they sure did. It went 99 yards, and then they got the ball again, and I don't think we'd ever stop Tillman. We needed something good to happen, and Boswell, I don't think I've ever known a player that extends everything that he's got, and he made a great play.
Vince, let's talk a little bit about Wayne Johnson. You seemed confident about him right from the very beginning in our pregame show earlier when I talked to you about it.
Well, Wayne Johnson, I told you, would never get upset. This wasn't going to bother him, all of this noise, and that's exactly what happened. It didn't worry him at all. So I was very confident about him coming in, real proud of him.
Coach, you've been very outspoken about some of the problems in recruiting in recent years. This is a very big game for you in recruiting to get the kind of talent that Georgia's accustomed to having.
Well, we played hard. We really extended ourselves, and I'm really proud of our team.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
I'll release you. Bye-bye. Vince Dooley, the victorious coach, and there's some kind of Georgia beach party on Peachtree Street tonight near Athens. Let's go back upstairs.
Tim, thank you very much. And now the fire hoses are coming out to try to get the fans off the field. It's a little chilly to be getting drenched down there. But the Georgia fans probably aren't going to mind. They just wanted to go out there and celebrate.
I don't think you could ask for more in a football game. Those last two drives, Auburn, that just isn't their style of play. Drive 99 yards, throwing the ball. They came back and almost put it in again. Just a great game.
Georgia fans being chased off the field. Some of them don't mind at all. And they're taking the Auburn logo apart at the 50-yard line. They want souvenirs. And the one place the fire hoses aren't being sprayed is at the 50-yard line. You can't blame fans for celebrating, but you don't want to see them tear up the field either. This is one of the prettiest fields in the country. And you can bet the groundskeeper is out there with something sharp trying to get 500 people off the field.
He's got his spade out there. I'll tell you, though, that the water's effective, isn't it?
Yep.
Got a lot of them off.
And, of course, these souvenirs aren't going to last long. Dead grass does not make a wonderful souvenir. After a couple of days, it just doesn't do much for you. Our Hartford player of the game tonight in this big upset 20-16 Georgia win is sophomore quarterback Wayne Johnson, 6'4", 203, out of Columbus, Georgia, starting his first game in a year and a half. He hit 6 out of 7 passes for 57 yards, 1 touchdown, and rushed for the other Georgia touchdown of the ball game. 12 points for sophomore quarterback Wayne Johnson. He is our Hartford player of the game. Vince Dooley getting the free ride and one he's probably enjoyed more than any this year as Georgia scores the major upset. We'll be back at Auburn right after this.